All right. Oh my goodness. It's Sunday night service. Sunday night service with Dani
and Dr. Motley.
Woo! So what is today? Today is February 25th, 2018. Can you believe it?
Almost March.
Happy Sunday.
Happy Sunday.
Happy Sunday. Happy Sunday. Are talking. Here, let's have a little communion. Sippy sip. Cheers. Sippy sip. Oh, I like that. Sippy sip.
Thank you. Ooh.
That's so funny.
That is sippy sip.
Okay. All right. I just got back in from New York City. Yes, as soon as you get logged on, click your heart button. Bonnie and Jeannie, you all never. These are two gals I graduated high school with.
No,
are on right now.
I
yes,
meet them one day.
We are talking sex tonight, part two.
Dos.
Sex part two.
Sex part.
Woo! Wait, sex part two. That's
directed
sounds...
by Dani Williamson.
Yeah. At least I'm not starring in it. I mean, that could be, I kind of look like a hoochie mama today. I've been in New York City for 5 days at the conference, and we'll talk about that at the end. But as you guys get logged on, hit your buttons. If you love what we're saying, hit your buttons, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so, oh my goodness, what a trip it was. So we are going to talk about a little bit more the male side of it tonight, right?
Yeah,
right?
We're going to
talk about a little bit more about the males. And I haven't had time to do a ton of research on this, but I got on a site that's Michael Castleman. So we're going to do, he was a Playboy sex writer.
Okay.
For 5 years. And he's got that amazing website that I told you all about 2 weeks ago. What the heck was the name of it? Greatsexguidance.com. So we're going to talk about the male writer version of this, things that he says about females and male sex, and the male side of it. Then we're going to talk about reading your mail. And I didn't know when I bought this book and I got on the airplane today that this is actually a Christian take on sex. And so it really worked out great, because I've got the Playboy side over here and then I've got the biblical side of it. And it's really quite fascinating. So I wish I'd had time to read it. I only got like 3 chapters read in it real fast. Then I fell asleep on the airplane. But, oh my goodness. All right, guys. So we got a bunch of people on. All right. Every single one of you guys that are on, click your button, click your heart button.
Give this thumbs up.
And then we're going to talk about our week at the end of this.
All
right. Mm-hmm. All right. Your hair looks good tonight.
Thank you. Yours always looks great.
Oh my gosh. Oh, mine has been traveling all day. I'm exhausted.
Hey, we have people that can do that.
So some of this is taken directly off of Michael Castleman's website. And he says, if men made love the way most women prefer, both sexes would feel more sexually fulfilled. Right?
Yeah.
Right? Because if the man's giving the woman what she wants, then they both are going to feel better. Now, if your husbands are watching or if your partners are watching, click your button on here. Let's see. I don't know if the men are, if there's any, I don't see any men on here tonight, but, all men have to do is let go of the idea that sex should proceed exactly like it does in the porn movie. That's what he says, right? There's more to love making than just between the legs, guys, right? Mm-hmm. So, again, talking about between the legs, this is what made me think, you know, what did we talk about last week or 2 weeks ago? There's only one organ, in case you missed it. There's only one. Oh, Dr. Ruth. Hey, Dustin.
Dr. Ruth. Dr. Ruth right here. Right there.
I'll be as old as her pretty soon.
There's
only one organ in the body that is dedicated 100% to one function. That's it. That's all it does is one thing, and that would be the clitoris, right?
Yes.
8,000 nerve endings.
8,000
nerve endings dedicated to create sexual pleasure for women, right?
Wow.
So that's a big thing. That's a great thing, but it's way more than just the clitoris. Sex is way more than just the clitoris. Love making is way more than just the clitoris. And this is where Michael Castleman goes with this. He talks about what are women's biggest complaints about the way men make love. What do you think it is, dude?
I would say the first thing that would come to mind is...
We haven't seen each other, by the way, because literally he just walked in the
door. I would say this, time.
Don't
they
look.
Prefer. I'm not like time they prefer. I mean, time, the time they take to make love.
Oh, yeah.
Is
bingo.
That,
it's more like a wham, bam, thank you, ma'am,
yes, yes.
With a man many times.
Okay.
All right. And so women's biggest complaint about the way males make love is that it's too rushed.
Too Too rushed.
It's
okay.
Too mechanical. Now, if you guys agree with this, click your buttons. Click your buttons. It's too rushed. It's too mechanical. And it's too narrowly focused on the breast and the genitals.
Oh,
right?
Wow.
Men go straight for two things.
The breast.
Boom.
And the genitals.
They're all over here. Uh-huh. Some people are agreeing with us here.
Yeah.
They go all over here and then boom, straight down there. Right?
Yep.
In many women's experiences, now I'm kind of paraphrasing here, many men simply want to plunge in. I made that up to intercourse. All right. Porn style sex, right?
Yeah.
Exactly how they do it in the porn movie. You don't see a lot of foreplay and playing around and all that. That stuff takes up time. They want to get to the main meat of this thing, right?
Yes.
Which also I read on there because I was looking up like pornography stuff. Oh my gosh, there's no telling what's on my computer.
Don't go over history tab,
yeah,
guys.
Right, right. But when they interviewed porn stars, they don't have orgasms on there. It's all fake. None of this is real on there. They do not.
They just have fake.
Yes,
fake.
Because women and men, women more so than men, they can't do that on demand.
Yeah.
And they are not in love with the person they're making a porn movie with.
There's no, I mean, I can't see how they could do that, like right on command. Yes.
Yeah, right. So most surveys show that women prefer when men shift away from the breast and the genitals, right? When lovemaking begins, right? They shift away from it,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
Women see the whole body as an erogenous zone, the entire body from the top of the head to the neck, to the ears, right? The arms, the back of the legs, the thighs, the low back, the whole, the feet, the toes, sucking the fingers, all that stuff. The toes. This is what I was reading today.
Oh,
I'm sure
man.
The lady on the airplane was like, what the heck? I mean, her eyeballs were cutting over there at me. I mean, I was, all right.
You know.
So they see the whole body as an erogenous zone, and they would love it if their man would explore more. Do you think that's true? Anybody that's on there who's got the nerve to push their button, do it. You know, would, do you wish that your man would explore more, right? Somebody does. Somebody's popping.
Guys, that's
up
a t-shirt. And Danny's going to be selling that
do you
t-shirt
wish
at her
your
office.
Man would explore more.
I can guarantee it's going to be on her. We're going to make sure
we
make a
t-shirt. Oh my gosh. Well, you know, this is so true. Once you think about it, most women resent men for rushing into sex, right? Really no kissing, no leading up to it. There's nothing. It's just boom.
Boom. Is it also to the play, like, you know, the interpersonal communication, like at a distance? Like, is that part of foreplay?
Well, that's a huge part of it. And they say sex starts in the kitchen in the morning before you ever leave, right?
Wow.
All day long. Oh, I'm thinking about you today. Can't wait till you get home, baby. You know, come home for lunch. How about that? Remember we talked about that afternoon delight, you know, come on home for lunch kind of thing. You know, and there's nothing wrong with a wham, bam, quickie, thank you, ma'am kind of thing every now and then. But as a rule, what he says, that's women's biggest complaint is that men are more like that. They don't explore. Women are explorers. Women are emotional, right?
Yep.
And sometimes men are more animalistic. Now, women can be too.
Yes. Yes.
But maybe men are just have been deprived. Good Lord, they just want to get to it, you know, because we're going to talk about that and about how we deprive men and how we, yeah, right?
Yeah, it's maybe it's the buildup that if you're playing games or not say playing games.
Oh, you can play games.
Let's go back to that.
I used to have a game of dice. Oh my gosh, it was so much fun. I wonder what ever happened to that. It was really fun. Now, I had this when I was married, by the way.
Okay.
All right. Men's biggest complaints. What are men's biggest complaints about the women they make love to? Men complain that women simply aren't interested. Okay. Well, now, they aren't interested. They're confused because their woman is not like the movies. Well, hello, no. I mean, and thank God we're not like the movies, right?
No.
We're real
women.
I mean, those are real women on there, but I mean, oh my goodness. Men are consumed with thoughts about sex, right? Mm-hmm. Porn movies do not show foreplay. They don't show flirting. They don't show the buildup to lovemaking. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know. I can't tell you last time I saw a porn anything. But, you know, I don't remember.
But it would stand to reason, though, like in the movie industry, how rom-coms, romantic comedies, like
rom-coms.
They call them rom-coms, right? Give me a thumbs up.
It sounds like something rom-coms. At Hustler.
No.
Excuse me. Can I get the rom-com?
You guys know what I'm talking about.
I don't
the rom-com.
What you're talking about.
And that anytime like they just come out, the ladies I know, they're all like, "We're gonna go see such and such." And what do most men say? They go, "I don't really care about seeing that." But that I also know that there are a lot of guys that love romantic comedies, like my friends who are the sensitives. They call us the sensies.
The sensies. The sensies.
The rom-com sensies.
Oh, good Lord. Okay, men are consumed about thoughts about sex, right? Porn movies do not show foreplay in that. And okay, so men are self-conscious, though. Now, this is interesting. They're self-conscious about the size of the penis. Mm-hmm. And why wouldn't they be? Look at you don't see little bitty penises on porn movies or in Playgirl. I don't know. Last time I saw a Playgirl, I was like 6 years old, 7 years old, and saw my Uncle Jimmy's. My cousin Jimmy, and I don't know if she's on here. We got in so much trouble. We found him. That's the last time. No, that's wrong. That was Playboy. We saw not Playgirl. We saw Playboy. Anyway, I haven't seen a Playboy in years. So why wouldn't men be self-conscious about the size of their penis, right? So that they're worried about that, as well as after the age of 40, men are worried about erectile dysfunction and, you know, not getting as firm as they used to in the past, or premature ejaculation, right? Which is a real problem, right? So these are the things men are stressed about. Those are the things women are stressed about, that men act more like robots and they don't know what to do with the rest of the body. If it's not the vagina or the breast, they don't know where to go or what to do. So those are valid. Those are valid complaints, right? Yep. So he's talking about here, there's a little section on there that said, let's come to a truce, right? So the sooner that men learn that the area between the legs is not the only area on a woman's body that will elicit a sexual response. Mm-hmm. In fact, even it's not even the top spot that's going to elicit a sexual response.
Oh, now, really?
Yeah, right? The sooner they learn that, the more satisfaction they're going to have in the bedroom and outside the bedroom.
Oh,
right? Because this is emotional.
Stuff,
this is emotional, physical, sexual. Women are emotional creatures. We're touchers, we're feelers, we're emotional.
Yes.
And some men are too.
Yes.
And in fact, men probably are more so than we think they are.
I think the people, like, they talk about the Enneagram, they say that the people who are the helpers, the guys that are the helpers, I'm a number two. And they say that we all, and I find it's true, that when somebody, I see somebody, I want to give them a hug, or I'll say, hey, you doing? I'll pat them. They say that is a natural thing for, like, some guys, like, you know, you wouldn't think guys are like that, but it describes their personality. Isn't that cool?
See, you'll be good when you have a girlfriend. Okay. For many women, whole body massage inspired caressing is the key to high quality lovemaking. Well, how many men really love to give you a massage, right? I mean, not many. You may love it, but I mean, not many. I mean, you guys can chime in here if you want, but there's not a lot of men out there that like to give a full body massage. Or if they do, it's just like two seconds and that's it. And it's like, well, what the heck? That was nothing.
They need to learn how to find all the sore spots.
That's exactly right. Yes. So, you know, I think there's few men. There really are few men that connect the dots to all the connect the dots, right? Reconnect the dots. Year after year of ignoring women's needs does lead to a wedge. Now, why are they ignoring needs? Now, we're going to get to that. Maybe they're not ignoring needs. They just don't know any better, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Women are emotional creatures, and touch is an emotional action that just may ignite the spark that's needed, right? Touch. So if there's any guys watching, and I know I see one watching, touch. Just a little bit of touch. Women are touch, although there's a sidebar to that, which we're going to talk about here in just a minute. Women get touched out all day long with little kids, right?
Yep, exactly.
So we've got a whole touch issue. Yeah, exactly.
With kids, yeah.
Yeah. So where do men learn this stuff, though? Where do men learn how to make love to women? Where do they learn this? What do you think about this?
I think where do men, like you say, unfortunately, maybe men learn it from porn movies or they learn it from their parents. And I think men
I don't know if you learned it from your parents.
Learn from genetic traits of the parents. Like if you say that, if somebody is a toucher or a feeler,
yes,
that means that somehow they probably inherited the personality traits of the parent, the neurochemistry, the biochemistry, and maybe that made them that way. Or they watched the interaction between the mother and father and realized that there was not much touch. So the young man's like, oh, I guess love is not shown through touch or through caress. It's just shown through, I don't know.
Well, they don't know how because they're not in the bedroom.
Learn from their friends. They learn from the locker room.
Got it. The locker room. That's the first thing I said. Men get most of their sex education from the locker room, from other guys, from pornography, which is either videos or they could be movies or they could be reading, right? Mm-hmm. And the sterile sex ed in school that does not talk about how to please a woman. Now, that would cause all kinds of problems, I'm sure, if it did. But, I mean, it talks about how to not get people pregnant.
Oh, yes, yes.
And so they're not going to learn it from that. And they're not going to learn it from their parents. Their parents are not going to say, although, mm-hmm. possibly, quite frankly, maybe parents should talk to their boys, hey, you know, look, this is not all about you, dude.
No, I think fathers should go and talk to their
Mamas can talk to them,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, totally, exactly.
Doesn't have to be the father.
No, it doesn't, because if you were raised in very strict homes or very personal
or a single
we don't talk about those kind of things.
Yes.
Those are the perfect breeding ground for kids who are afraid of sex, who think it's weird, and then they'll take advice from anybody about it. Just thinking, just sort of, what is it, going through the weeds, you don't know what it's really about, so... Man, well, you learn a lot from the locker room. It literally, like, the size of a guy's genitalia. Like, it basically does start when you're young. Like, guys pick on each other in the locker room. They'll say stuff, you know. And then you have this notion that women must think the same way, even though it's guys making jokes about it and such. You think, well, that's, you know.
I mean, I can't imagine. I mean, I really can't imagine thinking about the guy side of this, you know, what they're thinking the first time they're with a woman is, it, you know, or they, yep. what are they going to think about? I mean, I don't think anything about it. I'm a double A. I don't give a rat's tail. A vagina is a vagina, most likely. I mean, pretty much it is. I've seen a lot of them as a nurse midwife and all. But, you know, a penis is not just a penis. I mean, there's all different kinds out there. So I guess you guys are really insecure sometimes about stuff like
this.
Men
can get very insecure about that because it's, you know, like you said before that men are very visual.
Yes.
And they're
yes.
about appearance. Like, you know, women really love the way they appear as well. You know, like when they go out and stuff, but men have certain hangups too. Men should learn from their partner who has explored her own body and knows what she likes and wants.
That's exactly correct, Teresa. I agree with that.
Yeah.
And if a man is receptive to that, and I talked about that 2 weeks ago, you know, when you first get together with your partner, you know, if you don't give him guidance, how's he supposed to know?
Exactly.
Now, what he does with that is up to him. That's on him. And if you've got yourself in a marriage with somebody or relationship with somebody who doesn't listen to your wants and needs, now, that's a whole nother topic, isn't it? That's a whole nother show. Yeah. What you do with that?
People are sensitive. Like, when you walk in the room, I can tell she's the kind of person that can sense what's going on in somebody's head. Like, it is uncanny. When she sees somebody, she'll go, that person's this, this, and this. And I'm like, what? But but I would imagine if a wife or a woman, a girlfriend went up to her mate, and he was not that at all. He can't sense worth anything. And she expects him to sense that. Like, literally, that's the kind of time when you say, honey, this is what I want and this is what I expect. You'd have to tell him, like,
that's exactly right.
Because he may be a totally different personality type than you. So.
But wouldn't that be fabulous? I mean, if a man told me, mm-hmm. this is X, Y, and Z, this is what I want, my gosh, I think we want to please each other by nature, right?
Yeah. I think it's always a give and take because you would think that one person would say, this is what I want. And then, like, this is what I want. But the other person would say, okay. But I want to do extra stuff that makes me feel good too. Yeah. I think there's a balance there.
Well, it's give and take. It's give and take. We're getting ready to talk about
that.
Sometimes, yeah, that's exactly right. So, you know, men need to forget the whole genital preoccupation thing, right? Right. The whole thing. They need to start with the head. Women are, you know,
in
the head, right? Start in the head. No, they're not. They're in one place oftentimes, right? And learn to appreciate the leisurely time that it can take to build up to this. Now, I get it. We are busy and we are tired and we're raising children, right?
Yes.
But let me tell you, a woman has a back. She has shoulders. She has thighs. She has a neck. She has ears. She has all of these things that are extremely sexual to women.
Yeah.
And they are to men as well, I think, a lot of times.
They say that naturally in nature that we – that certain men love certain things about a woman. You know, like they say, are you a breast man or a hip man? They say that automatically when you see a woman, that's what, if you're that kind of person, you already seen the slope of their neck. You've seen how, seriously, the tallness of their forehead. They were talking about like the slenderness of their shoulders. And they say they can do it within a split second.
Isn't that something? That's fascinating to me. When men make love the way women prefer, men have fewer sex problems. Women enjoy sex more. And both men and women feel more loving toward each other. Well, I'm saying this, there's nothing here. But anyway, towards each other and more erotically fulfilled. Right? That makes perfect sense.
So do you think, like, because of men, we do operate a lot on our pride about how we accomplish or take care of somebody. So yes. We felt like we take care of the woman, it makes us feel better.
Sure.
After you've accomplished what she wanted.
And okay. When she's happy.
So guys, listen right? to your ladies.
Okay. So let's see here. So if guys want to give their woman the gift of orgasm, listen to what dozens of surveys, and I took this directly from Michael's site, dozens of surveys from the Height Report in 1976 to a recent study in England on partner satisfaction have revealed about how women prefer to make love.
Okay.
More kissing, cuddling, and sensual whole body massage. Do you ladies agree with that? More kissing, cuddling, and a sensual whole body massage. Slower pace.
Don't rush.
That's what I wrote. Don't rush into intercourse. Don't try to imitate pornography because these people are, I put in parentheses, these people are getting paid to fake an orgasm, right?
Exactly, yes.
Right? Okay. And when she feels ready for genital play, and she'll let you know when she's ready, direct genital loving caressing of her clitoris, et cetera, goes forward. I mean, and then you go forward, but you take your time first. Yeah. Now, not always does it have to. Yes. See, people like this. This is exactly, I don't think we're so off track here. So that was Michael Castleman, right? That was the Playboy writer, Psychology Today guy writing this. Then we get it, not writing this. This is stuff I was getting off of his website. And then we get into the reading your mail, which I think is a fabulous, fabulous title. She says, and her name is Mary Farrar, God has wired men with a stronger sex drive than females.
Okay.
Just has. I mean, really, he truly has.
Procreate.
As well as placing them on the innate desire to initiate, right?
Okay.
As a rule, men initiate sex more than women do until they are told no for 10 years or what have you, and then they finally do stop. But they've got the innate desire to initiate, and they have a stronger sex drive. Women are designed by God, though, to enjoy sex. When women feel loved emotionally by their man, they truly do enjoy sex.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
They do, when they feel loved emotionally, because women are emotional. Men are visual, right? Men are assertive and women are receptive by nature. Now, that's true.
That's true. Yeah.
Now, I feel like I'm assertive and receptive. I'm telling you, I've got it all, right? I can bring home the bacon and fry it up in a pan, but I'm tired of all that. I don't want to be doing all that. Anyway, a man's needs, listen to this, man's needs for sex, need for sex cycles 2 to 3 times faster than a woman.
Yeah.
Even the most virile woman is going to have a hard time keeping up with a man's sex drive. And I believe that.
Do you think that would be a turnoff to a female? And I'm asking you ladies out there, that a man keeps wanting sex, right? Even though it's showing to you that he wants you. Is that a turnoff that he wants so much and not allowing you time to rest? What would you say? I think, is that a turnoff, or is that glad that he still wants you that much?
Well, you better be glad. Well, you better be glad he still wants you because eventually, and she talks about this in here, eventually they don't. They give up and they stray.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
And anybody will, not just a man, woman will.
A woman too.
No, I mean, that's not just a man thing. So it says, okay, what about the way women and men experience touch throughout the day? This is huge. And I hear this every week in my office.
How
from
they
men
experience touch
throughout the day. So all day long, he leaves for work. Maybe you leave for work as well. But we're using this in the context of the stay-at-home mom with kids all over her, right? A man's word quota may be filled up when he walks through that door right there at 6 o'clock, right?
Yeah, okay.
He's talked all day long. He's been on business calls, what have you. And again, this could go both ways, but they're doing traditional roles here. His word quote is full. He doesn't want to talk right now, right? Yeah. He wants to go do his own thing for a minute. And all she wants to do is what? Right?
Okay.
Because she's been with little kids all day long. The same way, or his word quota is full, it's the exact same way that a woman's touch quota may be filled when he arrives home. So we're already starting with a deficit.
Word
at 6
quota,
o'clock. His word quota is full. Her touch quota is full, right?
Okay.
So then we're getting kids in bed. She's, you know, doing all this stuff. He's doing whatever he's doing. And then as soon as you get to bed, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
He wants to touch and she wants to talk. I mean, who agrees with
dun,
this?
Dun, dun.
Who agree? If you agree with this, hit your button because, you know, I hear this all the time. You know, I'm exhausted. I'm exhausted when we get into bed and he wants to have sex, right? And I just want to talk about my day.
Yeah.
So we're just all so imbalanced. It's just ridiculous.
Sad. Really,
right.
Truly, it's sad.
So he wants to touch, she wants to talk, and nobody's giving in. In order for this to work out, somebody's got to give in, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Somebody's got to give
in.
Totally. So maybe sex doesn't, maybe you don't have sex when the kids go to bed. Crap. Maybe you have sex while they're watching TV, right? You get in there and have some.
That's right.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, and that could be a little quickie, or you wake up in the middle of the night and I get it. So I read something amazing. Well, she says on here, we're just giving the crumbs to our husband. We're just giving them the crumbs, just leftover crumbs.
That's
hard.
Tough words,
man,
right there.
That hurt. Are you just giving him what's left over? Whoa. That's hard medicine.
And I think it'd be hard emotionally on the lady because the lady's like, that's all I can give. But it's,
yeah,
that's just the reality of the situation. Yeah.
Right.
I
then.
Mean, it's tough.
And it's the season.
Giving them the crumbs.
But
I
know that's hard stuff. So sex may provide relief mm-hmm. from exhaustion for a man, right? Mm-hmm. Relief from exhaustion.
Okay.
Right. And for a woman, sex has to be mustered up and we have to pull ourselves out of exhaustion to participate. So do you get that?
Yes. You have to pull yourself. Okay. Keep
right.
Going.
An exhausted man, it's a relief for them to have sex, right?
Yep.
But for an exhausted woman, she's got to really work herself up to it and has to do it. And that's true, ladies. I know this is true.
So that's where the 40 minutes of foreplay and stuff may come in at that time. Did we get ourselves worked up?
Right.
Get in-
right. So if you would just, if the guys, I mean, this is how I'm reading this is, you know, if a woman's so exhausted to have sex, but if you kind of really, you know, get her worked up into it
yeah.
just a little bit, play around, literally play around with her a little bit, rub her, touch her, talk to her, kiss her, lick her, do whatever it is you have to do, mm-hmm. right? Then maybe she's going to warm up. And I mean, the majority of the time, once sex is over and if people have had an orgasm or even if they haven't, they're like, I mean, my females in my office are like, wow, we wonder why we waited so long.
Yeah.
Why did we wait so long?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But for men, sex tends to give them energy
yeah.
and pulls them out of a bad spot. Even when a man's depressed, they want to have sex. I mean, this is, we're speaking, you know, just blanket statements here. Not every man, but you know, they when they're tired, when they're exhausted, it gives them energy. A woman, it doesn't. It relaxes them. I mean, and it relaxes a man too, but I mean, they're already tired and they just have to put this effort into it.
To it yeah.
But they don't have to put that much effort into it if the man will
exactly
give them what they're looking for before, right?
Yes.
I mean, my gosh,
yeah,
just a touch. I mean, I'm a touchy person. I'm a touchy feely person. And I love that. If somebody scratches my back, I am like putty in their hands.
Never really scratch
even how tired I am
on a kitten's back and they raise her back up. That's what that
right. Okay. Now listen, this is, I'm going to read this word for word. This is hard medicine, ladies. Okay. It says we have power. We have a power over men that is really strong. We can be oblivious to this power sometimes and sometimes not. So she writes this, is exactly out of here.
Mm-hmm.
We can breathe life into our men, or we can drain it right out of them.
Mm.
We can nurture them, or we can destroy them.
That's true.
We can bend them or we can break them.
Yeah.
We are a force to be reckoned with, and we always leave our mark.
Yeah.
Whoa.
It's true.
Is that true?
It's true. You know, I mean, if I know a lot of men that would say the same thing. It's like when they say, like, I'm putty in her hands, it's like literally that. Some guys, the toughest guys that I've known that have been like, yeah, I've run the ship kind of guy, you know, they jump how high she tells them to, you know, because it means everything to him, you know, like that she
basically. Well, this is what it says. Yeah. With all of his aggressive physical attributes that a man has, a man is surprisingly vulnerable to a woman.
Very.
And he's really vulnerable in the bedroom or when he's opening up about something. And we have to be so careful the words that we say to our men.
Yeah. Yes.
Right? Because we can, it's like daggers. And it goes, and for men too, they have to say, but we're talking right here how women treat men and how we break them down.
Yeah.
And how we can just put, I mean, we can say some hard, hard things, right?
Encouragement.
We can be the making of our man or we can be the breaking of our man. We enable and we disable our men.
Yes.
Is that true?
It's true. I think that men operate, and there's a lot of studies, and I know that the people who are in counseling and psychology would hopefully.
We have a counselor watching right now, Monty.
Monty. Oh, hey, yeah. Monty. I haven't talked to him in a long time. Yep. But encouragement, you know, women need to encourage their men. I'm not saying that we have to have praise. It's encouragement.
No.
But we also take advice well when a lady prefaces it with encouragement.
Mm-hmm.
Like, maybe this is something you do well, but you could probably improve on it if you did it this way or try it out this way. Maybe that, and we respond more to that because we do operate on a performance. And we do need encouragement. So encouragement is a big key. Doesn't mean you have to make everything like a praise the man time, I'm saying. But
I know. And you know, women in the office, I tell women this, look, they're simple. They're simple men. Yeah. Men are simple, right?
Yeah.
Eat well. They want good love and they want to be protectors. But we need to lift them up. And they're like, well, guess, you know, what's he going to do to me? But I'm telling you, you know, this is where it gets into somebody's got to give here, right?
Yeah.
Remember why you fell in love with this person, right? And remember what we said last week? There's only really about 2 good years statistically of sex, and then that's it.
Yeah.
And then everything starts to fall apart. I don't know what happens in 2 years if people start having babies or what have you, but, you know, we have to be so careful with the things we say to our partners.
Yes.
And our children, right? And I mean, words are swords.
Exactly.
We talked about this. So, and then I'm going to finish on this and he's going to start, not just some words to, you know, to leave you thinking, you know, is your husband, is your partner, is he your priority or is something else your priority? Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, you're right. You're right. So good.
Do we expect so too good. Much of him?
Ooh. Ooh.
Are we realistic in our expectations? Are you just a ball buster? I mean, straight up, is that, you know, is that all you are? Are you never going to be satisfied with anything?
I've seen that.
No matter how good it is.
Personally ruin a lot of relationships.
You bet it does.
A lot. I've seen that personally, like with my friends and stuff. That has ruined a lot of relationships.
And I really do think a lot of times, and I don't know this statistically, women are ball busters on men. And this is a sign of the times. This is where we are right now. You know, that we're tough. We're strong. This is equal. This is 50%. You better be pulling your weight kind of thing. You know, I birthed your child over here and blah, blah. You know, things are, there's some things that aren't better now than they used to be. And we are harder. We are harder. Our hearts can be harder now.
Yeah.
Right?
Our society.
Towards men.
Exactly. We've shaped that in women.
We have shaped it in women. And we have to be so careful how we shape it in our children.
Yes.
And, you know, with our sons as well. So, I mean, this is hard stuff. This
is
not easy, easy stuff. We lift him up. Are you lifting him up or are you tearing him down by what we say, right? Or what you don't say?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's equally as important, right?
Exactly.
Because you talked about that. We need praise and women need praise too. You know, if you're staying at home with the kids, we need to hear that. Or if you're out working, honey, I don't know how you do it. You know, let hear. I mean, but men need to hear that they're doing a good job, that, you know, good Lord, thank you for protecting our family and for taking care of us and making a living and for this incredible house. If in fact, you know, we're staying home and, right, and raising the kids, which is the most important job ever.
It is the most important. I always find
it's harder than what they're doing out there. I can damn tell you that.
I agree. I agree.
You know, men need it. They need some to get it. You know, they're a little, they need to be stroked. We all do.
We all need some love. Like, right? That, yeah. I think it's an equal give and take. Like, the more encouragement you give your man, the more support he'll give you. That's how I feel. And it's just like, it's what encouragement comes through words to a man.
Yes.
And his support comes through him not having to talk a lot. He's like, he'll do anything for you.
That's right.
And it doesn't require a lot of words. So it sort of shows how nature works, right? So,
right. Yeah, he will do that. And I wrote on here, we hold power over our men by withholding or giving sex.
Oh, look.
I mean, we tighten up, cross those legs quicker than anything.
Just like this.
Oh, we should have had that today. That's it. Right?
How do you know? That's
We do. We hold power over them. We give it, we withhold it or we give it to them. And I mean, they don't have a choice.
They don't have a choice.
You don't.
And some men just revel in the fact that they love that.
Isn't that something? So, you know, this is complicated stuff, and I've only read a couple of chapters in here, but I'm going to tell you, this is a great book to read. Now, they talk about women, men are very visual. Men are very visual, and she interviews a bunch of boys in here, and they're all virgins, which is interesting. They're in their 20s, and they're friends of her son, and they were talking about how difficult it is that they're so visual. And when they see a pretty woman and when they see, I mean, you're just geared visual and physical.
Oh,
you just are. And men think about sex so many times a day.
Well,
right?
I mean, think of how much sperm a man produces in a day, you know, and then that's just speaking to your brain. It's like, do I have an outlet?
Isn't that something?
It is. And crazy how we are designed differently. Like you know, especially like how, you know, turned on women get in a month and how turned on men are like every single day, basically.
Every single day.
And
women's
day.
Cycles, you know, it really does. But maybe women would be turned on more every single day if men were doing a few of those things that we mentioned on here. Again, and I do see that. And if men don't know how to make love to their woman, right, then they need to be taught. And I think that goes on our shoulders as the woman. You know, if you're unhappy with what he's doing, then you need to say something.
Exactly.
Instead of get angry and bitter and withhold sex because you're mad and all that kind of thing. I mean, we need to step up to the plate here.
Exactly.
As women, because you guys don't know.
We don't know. And if he's the kind of individual that would not listen to you, or then...
You need to call
something.
Betty Tindall, and you need to go to sex therapy.
Exactly right. But
right?
Exactly. But in that case, if you told a man what you loved and what you expected and how you wanted to be cherished, it's so much easier on a guy. Because what do guys say when they go, when you give them something to put together? They're just like, some don't follow instructions, but they just want to basically be told what to do. Put this together.
Yes.
Thing, you know,
there's
and that's
steps.
What they want.
People, they like steps.
We just
you know,
want
right?
to be told, in a sense, what to do in that manner. So it may not be for every guy. Maybe I'm just, but
I just can't imagine that a man does not go crazy and love the fact if he knows he's pleasing a woman. That because you can't help but know if a woman's pleased or not,
exactly.
Right? I mean, if he sees
unless
that look on her.
Unless you're a narcissist, you should have a guy that
and
loves
some
that.
People have done that in the past. Yes, and that's tough stuff. But I just can't help but think that a man wouldn't want to do more of that if they knew, because they're visual, right? And you watch someone who's being pleased sexually, good Lord, you can't mistake that.
Yeah.
Unless you've got something really wrong
with
you.
I guarantee the good men out there really want that in their lives. They do. I can see that. Like, good men would always.
But we need to tell them.
Yes. And they need to be encouraged. And they need to support you. So it's back and forth. But men need to be encouraged, again, in that simple, subtle way. Like, in my opinion, it's...
Well, your opinion counts. Harlan's really thrilled about this. He's sleeping up. Can you hear him? Can you guys hear him snoring?
He's like the Winston Churchill of Bulldogs.
Okay, so I'm finished with my part until the end.
Oh,
what are we talking about?
Oh, we're going to talk about with men, if there's any men talking, because Dani wanted me to just touch in on some of the things that men deal with, because I love that we talked about the emotional aspect of it, about how touch is a huge thing. And I think it's, on a side note, that mechanoreceptors, the touch receptors, the vibration, the touch, the wind across the skin, those vibrations hit the brain quicker than when your body can perceive it. It's like hitting a, touching a hot plate, and you pull back without even feeling the burn till afterwards. That's how sensitive the skin and touch and the mechanoreceptors are. So just saying that, I'm just thinking that way in this, in about neurology, how if you don't think that touch doesn't turn on people and really stimulate the brain, then you think you're thinking the wrong way, because it totally does. To get on the men's side, I want to make it real simple, because if I'm talking to men, we like just plain and simple, give me 2-3 steps. So I wrote it down on a board.
Yeah, he funny. Did. He comes in with this big board.
I just want to write, make it visual.
Okay.
Probably, okay, so real quick, guys.
Look, step. There you go.
Two things. Wait.
Yeah, put it all up there.
Two things we're going to talk about is ED for erectile dysfunction, and two is testosterone. Okay, so the two things we're going to talk about is erectile dysfunction and testosterone. And I want to make this as simple and as clean as possible. We're going to talk to you about the vascular tone, the pliability of the arteries, how movable, how elastic the arteries are within the nether regions, and that all comes down to the amino acid arginine. So I know that emotions has huge implications on a man if he has ED, and how he can be aroused, because I think it's the number one way to his brain to either turn him off or turn him on. Genetically, I would say that some men, if you're the man that has a problem getting aroused, and they love their wives, they are into it, then you'd have to look into your own genetics and your genetic outlook. Now, the biggest things that I think would cause some ED in your life, diet-wise, is the abuse of sugars,
yep,
trans fats,
yep,
and high amounts of wheat or grains.
Inflammation.
Inflammation will kill the prostate and make the prostate swell, decreasing the blood flow to the penis. And I'm telling you, I've seen, and you've seen it too, we've seen individuals come in our office and literally have that stuff reversed just by stop eating sugar.
You bet. Dr. Daniel Amen says if you've got a blood flow problem to the brain, to the penis, you're going to have a blood flow problem to the brain. So you got to watch it, because, I mean, those are precursors for dementia, all kinds of problems.
Oh, completely. And just that in itself, we could end the whole talk tonight, nutrition-wise. Like, just get rid of the sugars, get rid of the grains, and get rid of those inflammatory agents. To be nerdy as we are, to go a little step further, I would say this. I always talk about genetic tests. We know we really love talking about it and discussing it. But follow me out. The one thing I'd say for the guys out there, if you've done everything you know and things have not worked, I would say just look at this one more time, the NOS. You can go to a thing called Snippedia, and I'll write it down, or you can get your genetics test and check for the N as in Nancy, O as in Oscar, S as in Sally, the NOS, which stands for the nitric oxide synthase enzyme. So all I'm saying is arginine is an amino acid you get in your diet.
Yes.
NOS breaks it down to nitric oxide. If I don't kill myself, to nitric oxide right here.
Okay.
And nitric oxide helps blood flow.
Yes.
And all it does is make your arteries more flexible. It's like a rubber hose, seriously, from the house when you're watering the garden, right? When you leave a garden hose outside in the sun, it stiffens up, becomes brittle, and it breaks, right? In the sun. Follow me out. It stiffens up.
I'm sorry, I just had a horrible visual of it just breaking right off.
Breaking right off, guys.
Please don't leave your garden hose out in the sun.
Don't leave it out in the sun.
But garden,
the garden hose in the sun is inflammation. She's had a long day on the plane.
I had a horrible day. Yeah, I know I've had a great day, but okay. Yeah, don't leave your garden hose in the sun. That's all I'm going to remember out of this.
No, it's great. You look at
stiff and break.
You need to make sure that everything's pliable. So NOS keeps your arteries pliable. So there are supplements that you get at Dani's office, you get at mine. They're called, you can get arginine, but NOS is responsible for the breakdown. And you know, runners, like Lance Armstrong, the LeBron James, all those guys have high amounts of nitric oxide. They can get a lot of blood to their muscles. And so when we're talking about ED, you better be able to get blood to your favorite muscles.
Your favorite muscles.
So, but we've also talked about, remember, Dani and I, we discuss every Sunday night, and we're going to say, Lord, what can make the NOS work? I'm ordering to nitric oxide.
I agree, Dustin. Don't leave your hose out
In the sun. Don't let it get inflamed.
Oh, my gosh.
Does that make sense, guys? Isn't that a good one? Don't let the sun dry up your veins.
Don't go on a nudist beach in the South
Pacific.
Don't do that.
And the four things you're going to remember is, remember, on the genetics test, get your NOS levels tested. If you have a double homozygous or a heterozygous, you may have a tendency not to produce the enzyme, and that will allow that arginine not to be broken down to nitric oxide.
I didn't know that.
So you may have stiffness in the arteries. That's people who have, then it leads to cardiovascular disease, strokes, even pre-diabetics. So that's an NOS. And remember, guys, we're not just talking about the testes and ovaries. There's an interconnection. We talked about the thyroid, the adrenals, the testes and ovaries, and the pancreas. You're talking about insulin levels. We're talking about the thyroid, the TSH. We're talking about the adrenal levels. All those affect the testes, okay?
Yep.
So if you're going to do that, there are many men's vitamins and supplements out there.
My shirt keeps falling down. I'm covered up.
To help your body bypass that and give your body basically a straight shot of vasodilation. But it doesn't necessarily
do that again.
Look,
how's that
vasodilation
work?
To get the artery opened up. But it doesn't, not all of them. I'm not saying every one of those supplements do not help permanently, but remember.
Permanently.
Like
if it lasts longer than 4 hours, you need to go to the ED. I hate that name ED for the emergency department.
Oh my goodness.
It's an ER for crying out loud. Yeah, it does.
Sorry. But remember, to get these things, to get the NOS, that enzyme to be turned on, there are certain vitamins and minerals that we can talk about. And if you guys have questions in your head, you can always Facebook us and go to our Instagram and message us.
Yep.
And we can get more entailed and more nerdy about it. But remember, get that NOS tested. And we can discuss even further what minerals and nutrients you can help to regulate that so you don't have a dry artery.
That's bad, too.
Get the nitric oxide levels tested. So, in a nutshell, with ED and testosterone, guys, I would say that can cover ED, all right? So, can I say this to them real quick, Dani, while I do it?
So my takeaway from your talk is don't leave your hose. Don't leave your hose in the sun. And don't get a dry artery.
Oh, my word.
All right. Okay. So that's do you see?
Like, she is going to
do you see why we work well together? Because he's very intelligent. And I just hear all the dirty stuff out of everything that gets said. Okay.
The biggest thing, though, for NOS to balance it is antioxidants. So I'm saying if you take
antioxidants. So what are your antioxidants? They want to know that. Not everybody knows what antioxidants are.
Antioxidants would be vitamin E, vitamin C, alpha lipoic acids.
Yes.
You can do vitamin E, and you can do lots of berries in your diet and stuff. And they have tons of antioxidants that run around in there.
And the master antioxidant, my all-time favorite antioxidant, is
glutathione.
And they talked about it all this week in New York. If you don't have proper glutathione levels, nothing's going to work right.
That's right. So
nothing.
Make sure you go to time.
I mean, from Mark Hyman to Perlmutter to Jeffrey Bland to every one of them talked about glutathione.
Yes, and you need to have that. And if you don't have good glutathione, guys, relate it back to you. That means liver function is not 100%. See how it all ties in together? If liver's not working perfectly, then testosterone could be down.
Yep.
And remember, because going back to adrenals, if your cortisol is high, you could be robbing your body of precious pregnenolone. And you are not going to make DHEA, which you will not make testosterone. So, men, if you are overstressed at work, like she said, and you're tired when you go home, you really have to go get your cortisol levels checked and your thyroid levels checked. If they are low, you're always going to have low testosterone.
Yes, low testosterone's dropping. Do you know our testosterone levels are several hundred points lower now than they were in the 50s and 60s and, 60s. I can't remember. I have it on my notes, but from this week, but it's ridiculous. Our testosterone levels are dropping in this country. And they have changed the lab values to reflect that, which is really sad.
It is sad.
So we should not tolerate dropping levels or dropping IQ. You know, I shared that this week. Our IQ levels have dropped drastically. They're the lowest they've ever been since the 1950s in this country.
It is amazing how much we've stressed ourselves, how interconnected we are. And again, if you just drop sugar and you drop stress,
Anyway, that's my take on it. So remember, antioxidant guys, get your cortisol levels checked, your thyroid levels checked, and testosterone can be built up if you take care of your adrenals and your thyroid.
You definitely bet.
All right. So
as well as weight training.
Oh,
weight training will exercise will increase your testosterone levels.
Exactly.
As well.
Because you are not going to take your fats and convert it into triglycerides or something bad, which then can further clog up your arteries. All right. So you'll actually increase the amount of fat absorption and utilization to create energy. So
that's right.
Guys, it's so interconnected.
It is.
It's so interconnected. But those are the first steps with testosterone. Get that checked out. And I'm telling you, we take some good stuff and the good vitamins A, Bs, and Cs and get your exercising. That'll help. But remember, just message us and we can go further into the geek talk later.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, what are you going to do? Okay, so is there content? Is there content available after this? I don't know what that means. Exactly.
Are you talking about like content like to further discuss what we're talking about now? Is that what
you're saying? I don't know. I'm not quite sure. You can message us though. And we don't have any content other than this right here, but we can answer anything that you have up there that you, any questions that you have, but you know, so what are we going to do?
Message.
What are we going to do? How are we going to balance this out? This debate is going to go on and on and on and on for generations, right? I mean, it just is. Again, same stuff I talked about 2 weeks ago. You got to talk it out, right? Communication is key. If you're not happy, then communicate it, talk it out, because otherwise you got this wedge and it just gets bigger and bigger and bigger through the years, right? Through the decades. And then you may not even last, you know, the marriage may be over. And then, you know, I think, was it Joel Osteen or somebody said, you know, many times you give up your 90% for 10.
Ooh,
somewhere else.
That's a good,
Danny. Right? Well, I didn't do that. He said it. Joel said it. Or I paraphrased it, something about that. And I think that is true, right? The grass is not always greener somewhere else. You know, unless you made a horrible mistake, you married this person that you were madly in love with, then let's figure it out and let's get it back on track, right? Talk. Communication is key. And remember, your God, your spouse, your children, in that order.
Yeah.
That's the way it goes. Yeah. When we get that mixed up, things start to get out of whack, right?
Yes.
And again, what did we talk about last week? A way to bring it back, or a couple weeks ago. Hire a babysitter, have them take the kids out while you stay in and, you know, have sex and then go out to dinner. I mean, you know, whatever it takes to get it back on track, because, you know, the divorce rate in this country is ridiculous. We're at an all-time high.
Is it 50% or
something? Yeah, it's more than that. And
oh,
second marriages are even higher than first marriage divorce rates.
Man.
Which explains why I've not been married.
Being recorded. It is recorded.
This is recorded.
Yep.
This is absolutely recorded, and you can watch it and you can share it, Kathleen, with anybody you want. Yeah, it's every single Sunday night service has been recorded since the very beginning. All you have to do is look under videos, and it's there.
Mm-hmm. SundayNightService.net.
That's right. And are you cuddling? Shoot. Are you cultivating sex outside the bedroom? That's another way. Get it back on track, right?
Yeah.
Outside the bedroom. If you're riding
Make
in the car.
Exciting.
If you're riding in the car, reach over there and grab a hold of him or grab a hold of her. I mean, you know, in a good way, or touch her, you know. Oh, touch. I love touch. And again, texting. Afternoon sex, right? Call them home from lunch.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. They're going to come home.
You can play a song again.
And worst case scenario, if I can find it.
Book
worst case scenario, schedule sex and show up for it, right?
Ooh.
I mean, schedule it and then do what you want. Where are you going?
I need this book. I just want to show you
later. Oh, okay. All right. And then try new things. Do things that make you blush, right? Stop. What is it? Get out of your same-sex marriage, right? The same sex over and over and over. Well, that's boring as heck, people. That's just boring. Nobody wants to do anything the same for 20-something years.
You eat the same meal like every day of your life.
Some people do. So don't even go down that. Yeah, my grandfather ate the same pimento cheese, pickles, and potato chips for 30-something years that he worked at Penwalt Chemical Plant. Yes. And how about that? Stop fubbing each other, right? Stop fubbing. Get off your dang phone. Don't fubber. Nope. Harlan, you're going to knock the computer over. Don't fubber. All right. Yeah. Or him. All right. Okay. What were you going to say?
Oh, no, I just wanted...
What is that?
A patient of mine got me a book while I was in the hospital, and I really have enjoyed it. It's called The Road Back to You, and I know people have talked about the Enneagram, and the Enneagram is a really great personality test.
Yes.
And I would say that this book has a lot of good information, and it's written in a witty way.
Really?
That when you read it, you can start to understand, like any other personality book, about like the how another person operates or how you operate. But it does in a constructive and a truthful way to like see how you operate and the expectations. So for today's show, I was reading on this and I've learned a lot about myself even more. I mean, I've seen the Enneagram and studied it a little bit, but this was a great book. So
oh, wow. Yeah, that sounds great.
It's pretty fun.
Yeah. So, you know, guys, this debate's going to go on until we're long gone. People are going to be going over this. Maybe they'll be watching this 50 years from now. Who knows?
I hope so.
I don't know. Maybe I'll still be here. I'll be 102. I'd love to be talking about sex when I am 102 years old. Wouldn't it be great? Oh, my gosh, I'd love to. I'd be having sex when I'm 102 years old. That'd be even more fun, personally. But anyway, I mean, I'd love to.
We are definitely going to have a show if that's the case, guys.
Well, it'd be great. But anyway, you know, this is not so complicated, for crying out loud. Men want sex. Women want sex. We are designed as sexual creatures. So then just figure it out.
Yeah.
If you have got word deficit, and you've got touch or overload, word overload and touch overload, yeah, then sit down and talk. Say, man, I don't want to talk about anything when I come home, the guy, or, you know, I don't want to be pawed all over. I mean, figure this out, you know, and make it work. And yes, sometimes you're going to have to give. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you get, you know, and that's what it's all about.
It's not all about you, for crying out loud.
It's not all about you. Right. I want it to be a little bit about me. I mean, if we were in a relationship. But that would work even in business and in anything, you know, right?
Yes.
It's not so. This is not rocket science. We make it so complicated, though. Mm-hmm. We do. We complicate this stuff. I mean, and I just say, when I was I still am a midwife, but I don't deliver babies. But when I was a doula, you know, I would say, oh my gosh, the love that is in a delivery room when a baby is born, there is nothing like it. Oh. I mean, there is nothing like it. And I will never forget the first birth that I saw as a doula. And I remember telling when I was teaching childbirth classes, I'd say, you know, if you can bottle the love that you feel for your spouse or partner, whenever there's a baby, that baby's born that you two created from nothing, from a sperm and an egg. You can't even see it. You built a human. If you could bottle that love, because I mean, it's unbelievable when a baby's born, and you can rekindle that 10 years from now, 12 years from now, 5 years from now, when you're at each other's throat, nobody's had sex, everybody's fighting, you're in trouble financially. I mean, if we could remember that and go back to that moment, I mean, my goodness, how many marriages could we save?
Oh, wow.
And go back to that and start working on it? We give up.
We do.
We give up.
We do. I think we've gotten to an age where people have expectations of others. Like, they already expect the other person to know what they're thinking and what they're doing. But I've heard a great quote. It says, expectations are basically resentments in another form.
Whoa.
Like, it truly is right. If you're expecting it. It's the difference between my thoughts, like you say, investments in love. If you are giving to somebody because you, as much as you want to be selfish and get so much in return, then it's an investment because you're thinking, as much as I put into it, I'll get back. But if you give into it without anything in return, like any expectation, then that's love.
And you bet.
You work back and forth.
You bet. Kim said, Kim and I went to high school together, and Kim says, Miss Ruth and Thomas, 96 and 91 years old, they were still having sex. He just died, but they were ballroom dancers. Oh, yeah, she's fabulous. She was this, Ruth is something. I know, 96 years old and still having sex, and he's dead. Oh, he just died, but he died, yeah, just recently.
That's amazing.
Yes, Kim, that's how I want to be, man. I want to be like that. But anyway, guys, we love you. And we
love you guys.
We do. We do. But next week, we're talking about heart health. We will be missing. We missed it. February's Heart Health Month. So we're going to be a week late. But we're going to talk about cardiac disease, heart health, the first signs of cardiac disease. We're going to talk about magnesium, this book right here, Magnificent Magnesium. We're going to talk about how I got this book this week and all that good stuff. I'm not talking about now. But so next week, tune in for that because it's going to be good. I mean, heart disease kills more women than breast cancer does. So, you know, it's a big deal.
It's
a big deal. And the number one sign of cardiac disease is sudden cardiac death for most people. You don't get a warning. You don't get a second chance. So this Friday night is the Hashimoto support group meeting. I'm going to put that up tonight. So if you want to come to that, RSVP, it's going to be me this week, this month, talking about everything I learned at the Integrative Healthcare Symposium this week. Wow. It's going to be good. CBD oil, brain health, inflammation. I mean, I can't wait to share with you all the stuff that I learned. So that's this Friday night, 6:30 at Nashville Restorative Dentistry. You're welcome to come if you want, Dr. Ryan Jones's office.
Oh, Ryan.
We'll be starting our yoni steaming here in about 2 weeks, and I'm excited about that.
I'm excited about it.
Dr. Leslie Hsu is doing an interview. She's videoing it. We're steaming together and doing her video. Right, and so I'm excited. We're doing it this weekend.
So, you guys are going to have a blast. Staying clear.
Yeah. So we've got all kinds of stuff. I got a sauna coming in. I ordered it for the office. I ordered a sauna. I'm really excited about that. So yeah, all kinds of great stuff. What do you have coming up?
I just wanted to say that.
Yes, it was excellent, Lisa. It was excellent. We had a ball. That's why I'm going to talk about this book here. We had breakfast this morning before I left, actually. And so we had a really good time. We went out 3 times in 5 days. That was fun.
Look at this girl. She's going out left and right.
No, I'm not. Not really. It was fun. He's a great, for those of you who don't know, he's a cardiologist. You can look him up. But he's probably 70 years old. I don't know. He didn't tell me, but he's got a great accent. He's from
South Africa.
Where is he from? South Africa. Yeah, he gave me this bracelet too, Lisa, this morning that he got in South Africa from the ladies there, that the little South African ladies. They're handmade. It's beautiful. So anyway, yes, it was fun, and we'll talk a little bit about it. But what's going on with you?
It's going to be a busy week. We've got, repainted the office. We repainted ours.
Yep, our office was painted this week.
We've been just hammering out. It's like one of those things, getting back, getting stronger and getting a little more strength in the body.
Yes, you look good, by the way. Your hair's looking good.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, it's just been really nice, hectic. We've been having a lot of people come in. So get a start on the mini series about Lyme infection in about a week.
Good.
And I am going to throw out some more videos, hopefully, that will maybe post it to YouTube, just about certain things that we talk about in the office. But
do y'all want us to talk about Lyme disease in 2 weeks? Would you want to do that?
To do that. That'd be fun.
Yeah, you want to talk about, well, not me. I don't really talk much about Lyme disease. But you want Dr. Motley to talk about Lyme disease in 2 weeks? If you want him to, let's do it. Click your button and hit your heart button, and
please. I love to discuss it, and we've had a lot of people that have come to the office lately and that have had Lyme and have had parasitic infections, and we have found that I've had many calls already this week that when I came in back to the office, I sort of hold back on many new patients. But we've had so many calls for people with Lyme infection. So
yeah, it's huge. And that'll be great. We'll be getting into spring. It'll be March next.
It'll be
in 2 weeks. It'll be second week of March.
Hopefully they killed most of the ticks off this year. I hope the cold did. I don't know, but we'll see.
All right, guys, we went over a little bit, 2 minutes, but we sure do love you. And, you know, this whole sex thing, we could talk about it every week. You could have a whole show on sex. We're not ever going to settle the debate.
Nope.
Women love touch. Women do not want, they're not all about the breast and the vagina, right? So guys, if you're watching, there's a lot of body surface here, area here. You know, it's more than the breast and the vagina. So how about you explore a little bit of it? She'll tell you what she likes. If you are halfway in tune with your woman and your man, right? All you have to do is listen to the breathing, right? Well, I'm telling
you. You're right. I love it. Keep going.
What? Somebody's got to say this stuff.
I just keep thinking when you say, you ever seen Austin Powers?
No, I don't know anything about Austin Powers.
He's a British spy, and it's a comedy, and he always goes, "You mean one of my world famous sensual massages?" World famous sensual massages.
Well, so anyway. There you have it. And so if I'm getting one of those from him, he's going to know by my breathing.
By your breathing.
I'm telling you. And I mean, all you have to do is listen. Listen.
Yep.
Listen to your man. Listen. What's that little video that went around? last year. Listen, Linda, not listen. But all you have to do is listen. Because I'm telling you, your man and your woman will tell you what they want. But for darn sure, we're talking more tonight about what men need to do and how they need to focus. But, you know, yeah, right. We need to be nice to our men as well.
Encouragement equals support. So it sort of feeds back. I mean, you know, more support in that manly.
The more you encourage him, the more he's going to be putty in your hands.
That is exactly the truth right there.
There is something.
And we like being the putty in a lady's hands if she treats us right.
Now I just got to find a man to be putty. I mean,
you went out three times in New York City.
Yeah, like, that doesn't mean anything.
With the head guy that talked City. At the conference.
All right, we're going to talk about this. Yeah, no. Oh, that was fun. Woo-wee. All right, guys.
See ya.
Bye.